Dig deep down on the planet X. Y'all. Oh, I know what the problem is.
You were having a problem?
If I keep my headphones in queue, I only hear through one side of my headphones. Testing, testing. 1, 2.
Testing, testing.
1, 2.
1, 2. Now, we are now testing this out for proper modulation.
Yeah.
As you will
There's
know,
a party.
Those happy days. Happy memories.
Happy days. Lady Gaga is in concert tonight.
That's right.
Sirius XM tonight at the Apollo, a very small theater. A couple of our listeners are going to go.
And Gary.
And Papa Fooey, of course. He doesn't miss a night out. I am not going.
Nor am I.
Gary is the only staffer going because he's not concerned about getting up early tomorrow. He says he can do. He can multitask and do both.
I will be in bed earlier tonight than if I, because I'm staying in the city. All and right. It'll be done early. The show's done by 9:45.
Well, why not take a nap now, right during the show? And
because I'm working, right. Weisenheimer.
Thank you for addressing me by my real name, Weisenheimer. I really wish I could go. Like, that's something that would interest me.
I was like, what day is it? Please be a day that I could go.
Well, we take our jobs very, very seriously. And I mean, except, you know, Gary does, of course, too.
You know what? This is one of those ones that my wife really wanted to go to.
Well, my wife is going. I'm not going, which is killing me, too, because I would like to have a night out on the town with my wife. But I have work tomorrow. But you'll be fine, Gary. Don't worry about it.
There won't be any drop-off in productivity.
No, I feel his productivity will be right where it always is. And probably his voice will be a little phlegmy, but I'll sit through it. Don't worry. I'm going to purposely put you on mic tomorrow morning to hear you.
I'm no longer going.
Boff. I can't clear my throat. I don't know why. Maybe because you went out to the Lady Gaga show. No, boff.
I'm going to sleep the same time that I go to sleep. I go to sleep every night at 10:40.
Yeah, you're
going
to be charged up. You're going to get to the hotel. It might even be noisy. You might not get to sleep.
Yeah. I have an hour extra to sleep in the morning. Because I'm not driving.
I bet you it's going to be a lot of this.
Something for you to look forward to, Howard.
Yeah, yeah. I'll get the aftermath. He'll be fine at the concert. Joe, do you answer the question about the Super Bowl III? Thinking back on it now, did you make love the night of Super Bowl? You did. The night before. You did. Because that's how you win games. That was your modus operandi.
Is that what the Colts forgot?
Yeah. The Colts should have banged them. You did have sex the night before. I would think you would be so nervous. You know what I mean? Like that would be the night. Although maybe...
Out of respect to my then girlfriend who was down there, I never told that story.
What do you mean?
What do I mean? There was a knock on the door after curfew.
Oh.
No kidding. In other words, you were.
And
you
it
were
happened to be a lady from New York.
How did she know where you were? Did you tell her?
I mean, I think somebody sent her because when we were there, she started chuckling after a while. She said, my dad, he'd go crazy if he knew I was
oh,
here.
Oh, my goodness.
I said, why is that? She said, well, he's in Baltimore.
Oh.
She was from Baltimore.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
that's
dear.
Like, that's
and
like
then
treason.
I figured they tried to mess me up.
You think she was sent in by the opposition?
Do you get that paranoid that you say, hey, wait, maybe the Colts are up to something?
No, I wasn't that paranoid. No, when I gave it thought afterwards, of course, though, I thought that somebody was up to something. I thought it might have been some wise guys that went the other way. And
was she a great beauty, this woman? She must have been.
She was, yeah, she was nice. She was a waitress, cocktail waitress up here. And
did you have to be on guard when you were with a woman like that? Because I'm talking about the night before the Super Bowl, because it's a story. You know what I mean? You're Joe Namath. It's a Super Bowl. It's this.
Well, Howard, I've never said that before in my life to anybody here. I'm telling you that this is the first time that I admitted to that.
Really? To what? To having sex the
night before
the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
With a cocktail waitress from Baltimore, no less. Wow. She might have cost Baltimore the whole Super Bowl.
And I didn't plan it. I told you after the coach left, there was a knock on the door.
Little Weezer for you. I like those guys. Weezer. Good name, too. Weezer. The chorus is so good. You know that riff?
Here we go. So let's get into it. Oh, yeah. Say it ain't so. Oh, oh.
Your joke is a heartbreaker.
Yeah, hit me with it.
You're like, this is great.
Oh, yeah.
But everything's good. Jason's dancing. JD wants a smack of the head.
He's making your ground shake. It feels like a construction.
It's a floating floor, JD.
It's floating, all right.
Bobo was really, you know, he is a super fan. You'll notice that he's wearing a bag over his head because he'll be unveiling his new face without hair.
Can somebody just walk him into the door?
Listen to me.
Bubba, like why are you walking in like you can't see? There's eye holes.
I can see, but I can't see the mic that's in front of my mouth here.
You can see, but you can't see the mic.
Now I can see.
All right. Bobo has been calling into the show for how long, Bobo?
About 27 years.
I'm going to now let you unveil your new look. Do you want to say something before you take the bag off?
Yeah, this is an end of an era me with this hair system. It's been on me since the mid-80s, Howard.
Do you feel liberated not having a hair system?
I finally do now, and, you know, my
are you glad that we were pushing you to get rid of your toupee?
What is that?
Are you glad we pushed you to get rid of your toupee?
Yes.
Yeah.
We've been pushing since we met him.
As you know, Bobo now has lesions on his head. He's afraid it was from the hair glue from his wig. Now, for the first time on the show, Bobo will remove the bag over his head. Here it goes. So dramatic, Robin.
Well, I want to do a build-up here.
Yeah, it's coming on very slowly. Time to come out of the bald closet. Oh.
You know, I wanted to go scream, put it back, but you look,
I do look good,
so
right?
Much better.
Yeah. You have a good shaped head, except for the lesions.
Yeah.
It's very round. Your head is in a bad shape. Yeah, you actually,
right?
You look fine.
You look great.
Yeah. you really look fine. Now put the bag back.
Yeah.
Let me see your old toupee. Say goodbye to it. We're going to keep it here at the show.
Oh, we've a douchey.
It was never doing you any good.
Is the hair system.
Shuli wants to try it on. Do you mind? Hope you don't get lesions, pal. Here's Shuli, who's been bald for a long time, who's finally going to get some hair. He's going to use Bobo's hair system. And let's see. Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
Now, look there how stupid, you go. It's Mo.
Exactly.
Look how stupid Shuli
I can't believe
looks.
I won, I think, for those years.
This is how dumb you look.
See? You're right. You can spot it from a plane.
You somehow look older with that.
Every day you walk out of the house thinking nobody noticed this.
Right.
Are you out of your fucking mind?
Ronnie, if you want to believe him, Ronnie the limo driver, at one point Ronnie said that he's leaving at the end of this contract either way.
Is that right? I didn't realize that was where we were with Ronnie.
Well, Ronnie's 69. He'll be 71.
Yeah, but he's got more energy than all of us.
69!
I got to say, the guy still fucks like a young man. I mean,
maybe if he stopped doing that, he could work a little longer.
Yep. I'm interviewing new head of security people.
New short people to head your security.
Yeah. I'm interviewing somebody who is about 4'11" and he's 74 years old. Ronnie was guarding me the other day. We were walking. I go, this guy can barely walk. How is he guarding me? Are you still sticking by that, Ronnie? Like, I deserve some notice. I mean, I am starting to interview
people.
I felt like it was sort of vague still. I wanted definitive.
Is it official?
Is it official that you are done at the end of my contract?
As far as I know, yes.
What do you mean?
As far as you know.
Well, who else would know?
No, I said as far as I know. That's my plan.
That my plan is to replace you at the end of that time.
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, is right.
Why?
Nothing. I just can't believe it.
Isn't there a time that you just want to lay back and...
Well, what do you have to do?
You're not laying back.
Tine, tine, tine.
What the fuck is your problem over there?
There is a season.
Motherfucking
tine, tine.
You're going to sleep also.
Is that what you want to do, though, with your life? I mean, you get a lot of fun out of this show.
No, I enjoy it. I love it here. You know that.
You got Twitter, and then you get on the air, and you mouth off and everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know.
He's going to be miserable.
Why do you think I'll be miserable?
Because if we're still here and you're not, you're going to hate it.
But I won't be here. I'm going to move away.
Where are you going?
I'm planning to move to Vegas.
If you leave, who's going to protect us from the poison bagels?
I don't know where it came from. Go fuck yourself.
Or Gary's Donuts.
Yeah.
It's time to hang up the cock rings.
No, I still use those, man. What are you talking about?
At some point, your cock's going to start not working all that great.
It probably won't.
Yeah.
I'm assuming.
So you're probably just going to have to go down on Stephanie every night.
I think that what he's doing is he's conserving himself for that.
Right. No. Why?
Yes, he is.
Why do you think that?
Ronnie will turn into a lesbian because all he'll be able to do is eat out his chick.
Come on, let me munch your box.
Why do you think that? I mean,
I think that because you're burning the candle at both ends here.
No, I'm not.
I'm putting the candle in my ass. What are you talking about?
Yes, Sal, you're on the air in Massachusetts.
This is Ronnie. He's out of his fucking tree.
Why am I out of my tree?
Dude, I do this for a living. I would cut my left nut off to drive a guy like Howard around.
Dude, I've been here 34 years, okay?
Who cares? Where are you going, dude?
I'm going nowhere, dude. That's the whole plan, to go nowhere.
Drive Howard around, shut the fuck up, and do your security.
Oh, you go fucking drive in Massachusetts.
You got the dream job.
Well, you're right.
What are you doing, dude?
Sal. You go to work, you sit there, you see movie stars, and you're complaining.
I'm not complaining.
Is Stephanie looking forward to seeing you all day?
No, she'll be at work.
She'll be at work. And what are you going to do?
He's going to be sitting by the pool.
I'll be spending time with my dildos.
You don't read. You don't have any hobbies.
You know what he's going to do, Howard?
Yeah.
He's going to get in his car and drive around.
I know. He might as well drive me.
Let's see. What can I do today? I know. I'll drive to Henderson and back. Yeah.
Fred, what are you going to do if I retire?
I'm going to go on the subway with my Ronnie puppet.
Right. By the way, you were in the booth with Frank Gifford and OJ. Now, were you friendly with OJ? Did you know this guy outside of the booth?
I got to know OJ, yes, socially, and we didn't hang out. We never hung out.
When you see, like, you fast forward to, you know, the car chase when they're following OJ, you're probably sitting there, holy, this is crazy.
That's the guy?
That's OJ.
That's OJ.
No, it wasn't crazy because I did work with OJ for a year. And
Hothead?
Not with me. And I never saw him really get angry or whatever, but he had his style.
Well, you're saying, in other words, you saw things in him that would indicate a guy who might go off and do something stupid.
Well, you know what? I still try to live by, if you don't have something good to say about somebody, try not to say it at all.
Was he mistreating women? Is that the thing you saw?
Well, maybe, I spoke of loyalty to a woman or a guy when you're together, and that can be breached a bit, and that kind of drops your credentials a little bit.
Can I read between the lines that you saw a married guy hitting on women, and maybe even when you were with a woman, maybe hitting on your woman?
No.
Never.
No, I wasn't with a woman in his company.
Right.
Yeah, leave the women out because OJ's here.
OJ's here. Everybody get rid of their women.
I didn't meet anybody else. No. I mean, that wasn't it. It was just we didn't hang.
Why were you disappointed with this orgy that you went to this past weekend?
First, to be completely correct, let's not call it an orgy. Right. It was more of a voyeur exhibitionist type thing. Everybody there had sex with the person they came with.
Right.
And other people watched, but they were...
But you could do that at home.
Exactly.
Well, who's watching now?
I mean, you came there to fuck other guys' wives and have other guys fuck your wife.
Correct.
And the rules, when you walked in, the rules, they say to you, hey, by the way, you can only fuck your own wife?
How disappointing.
I mean, honestly, if you're going to an orgy.
And it was the same host and hostess, so I thought it was going to be an orgy again.
Oh.
Did they get you there under false pretenses?
I think this one was a lot of people that were a lot more vanilla than actual swingers.
Did you ask to talk to the manager?
Well, the host and hostess at the end of the party, I did talk to them.
And what did you say?
I was like, this one is not like the last one. You know, like, this is a lot of, because last time the host and hostess were participating.
Right.
They were mixing it up and everything. Right. And this one, the host was only giving women massages and not going any further than that.
Wow, like, why all of a sudden?
That's what...
Do you think they're doing it to make money, maybe, in some way, and this is to bring in a different kind of crowd?
Right. I think this one tagged on to the Mermaid Parade, which was Saturday.
Oh, I see.
Was more of a curiosity, oh, it might be fun to go there.
So what were you wearing? Like, what do you wear to a mermaid party if you're a dude?
So I just wore a tight T-shirt that had, like, orcas on it.
In other words, to show that you're the guy who captured the mermaid?
I just... It said make an effort. So right. Like it, so
and what did your wife wear?
So she wore a see-through top with like pink seashells over her tits.
I mean, she's full on swinging because she wants DP.
So that's something that she wants. She's interested in trying.
What does that mean?
It's double penetration.
Yeah, like, what does
that
mean?
Two guys. You have one in the pussy and one in the asshole.
That's what your wife wants.
At the same time. She wants to try that. Yeah.
She is hardcore.
She is, man. She's
wow. You want to see that?
Yeah.
You don't want to be part of it?
I mean, I could be, like, in the context of a party last time, I had my scenario going, and she was next to me with her scenario going. So that's the way I saw it going is...
Brent, man, you're in a very unusual mindset, I got to tell you.
Wait, because you said you'd do the DP?
I would do it.
And what if the other guy comes on you?
You're wearing condoms, so the guy's not going to come on you.
Well, fair enough.
Got it all figured out.
So the update is, you tried it again.
Yeah.
You go to the party. They say don't fuck any other women and don't fuck any other men, and everyone stay with their own partner.
The rules this time were a lot more a laundry list of rules.
Wow. Wonder what changed.
I think it was, like I said, I think it was tagged on to the Mermaid Parade because there was probably 10 to 15 old bags there. That thought it was like, you could tell they thought it was like maybe interesting to go there and get dressed up in something sexy, which is nothing that you would want to see.
Poor Brent. Sounds like the orgy was practically a Sunday school.
Yeah, it was It was not good. And of everybody that was there, was maybe six couples actually had sex, I mean, with each other. It was...
How old is an old bag that was there? Like, how old are
these? I'm telling you, 60 plus.
Oh, really?
It'd be like seeing your mom or your aunt naked.
It was traumatizing.
It was traumatizing. And they're sitting in like a circle taking up two beds talking.
Did you guys fuck in front of the group?
Yeah, we did
do
that.
Oh, you did?
We did do that.
So at some point your wife goes, hey, maybe we should fuck.
Yeah. She said, while we're here, you know, we might as well do.
So how do you fuck in front of the group? Like, how does that all get going?
So us and two other couples decided, hey, we're going to get, there's the old bags were taking up a bed on one side of the room. So the other side of the room.
Let's fuck for these old bags.
There's the other side of the room is another bed that was empty. So the three couples got down there and we all had sex with each other and kind of touching each other. But that was it, which is not very hardcore.
When you're done, does everybody applaud? Like, how does it, like, no. When you're done, do you just get up and walk away?
Yeah, I did. Because people are watching. Imagine like
are people jerking off while you're fucking your wife?
No, you can. But people aren't. It's like they're standing down the middle of this aisle like it's a business mixer having drinks, like talking with each other.
Did you even come?
I didn't. She did. I didn't.
Wow.
I couldn't. I found that all scene all very strange.
For you?
For me.
Wow.
Yeah. I like a more hardcore, you know, fucking scene.
This sounds like a nerd party.
Me fucking my wife in front of a bunch of people. That's hardcore to me.
Oh, yeah.
Old bags.
Yeah.
And then one of them comes up to us and says, hey, do you want to join us for a cuddle puddle? I'm like, a cuddle puddle?
What is a cuddle puddle?
And they were like, that's where we all lay on the bed and cuddle sensually. And my wife is just like, we're way more hardcore than that.
This is a woman looking for a dick in her ass.
So no. Yeah,
maybe two.
Cuddle puddle.
There's something you don't bring up in the book. And I think it's to me anyway, it's a big turn. And I don't know how you feel about it. But 9/11, I remember on 9/11, no comedians, none of us were on the air. We couldn't be on the air for a while. But you narrated it as it happened in real time and reacted. And I thought of you as you're not a CNN broadcaster. You're not that kind of broadcaster. I think of you as more of a late night comedian. I thought, Howard's more like one of us, and you were reacting in real time to it, and your response to it's incredibly honest. And I know that you've subsequently played it on the anniversary, and it's really powerful, and it's hard to listen to.
Yeah.
Because it's such a painful day.
I can't listen to it.
But I always thought that that was a moment where, against your will, maybe prematurely, maybe you were ready for it, but you didn't want it, you were forced into this situation that you had to take us all through that day. You were on the air, and you did. And it sort of it was an advanced look at where you were going. Does that seem like it's possible?
It was a horrible day. I'm sitting there on the air. Someone comes in and says, you got to put the TV on while I'm on the air. I'm live. And I didn't have any thoughts of like, I was helping anyone through this or whatever. I was just, again, I was
in the moment.
I was in the moment reacting to what I saw. And I immediately said to Robin, the first plane hit, I go, this is an act of terrorism. And everyone was kind of like, no, you don't know that. You know, it could have been, I go, it's a clear day. This is an act of terrorism. And then the second plane hits. And then and then everyone in the tri-state area starts calling me, people who could witness what was going on. And suddenly real reporters were calling in the sense that everyday people who were sitting there were able to report on their feelings and what was happening. And we all shared this together. I felt I should just sit there. We had already done like a 4-hour show, and we were on the air till then, like noon. We did an extra 2 hours, but it didn't occur to me to leave. It just seemed like the right place for me, that I would be the most useful.
Right.
And honestly, Conan, I was sitting there in shock. I was really fucking angry with these goddamn terrorists.
But what's amazing is that that's a document now.
Yeah.
I mean, that is a document that. And I think it's probably one of the more compelling documents. I can't look at the footage of that day. I don't think a lot of us can.
Right.
I lived in New York. I was watching it all unfold from my apartment while it was happening.
Yeah, I didn't know what to do with myself.
But your show that day is a document of kind of a real-time document of an honest person's reactions as things are laid out. And because it exists, and as I said, reporters can't say the things that you say. You're reacting as a real person. And I always felt like that day, and I think a lot of us felt this way. I know a lot of us felt this way. Oh yeah, Howard helped us get through that day. You were on the air as it was happening. That was the first time that I heard you in a different way.
Yeah. Ronnie is the worst speller in the world, and we were wondering, could he beat like just an ordinary sixth grader? So we asked Sal's son to come in, and Sal's son is going to challenge Ronnie to a spelling bee. All right, let's meet a very cute kid, a nice kid, Sal's kid.
Sal's kid.
Where is he? Jason, you've gotten so fat, you blocked the kid completely out. I couldn't even see him walk
like
in.
It was like he was behind that wall Trump wants to build.
Aaron, hi. I got to tell
you. What's up, man?
What's up, Ronnie?
Hey. Aaron, you're in sixth grade, and we wanted to see how Ronnie would perform against it. We all know your dad, Sal. He's been working on the show for a long time. Do you know what Sal does here, your dad?
He told me, like, he usually, like, writes jokes. Like, he's on the show sometimes, like, stuff like that.
Do you know how to spell Aaron, Ronnie?
Yeah.
How?
Well, there's a couple of ways of spelling it. Some people spell it A-R-R-O-N.
That would be a roan. I think you're going to beat Ronnie. My money's on you.
Good. Good.
Aaron is A-A-R-O-N.
Yeah.
No, some people spell it that way, too.
A-R-R-O-N?
Yes. I don't think I've ever, like, actually seen someone actually do that.
All right. Everybody knows everything. It's okay.
All right, Aaron, Ronnie, it's time to play Spelling Bee.
Are they going to stay right there on the couch?
They're going to sit there right on the couch. Why not? What's the difference? Right, Ronnie? What's the difference?
Yeah, Ronnie couldn't stand through the whole game anyway.
All right, fellas, who wants to go first? Ronnie or
Aaron?
Doesn't
matter.
I guess I'll go.
You'll go first?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, the first word up is vegetable.
Vegetable.
Yes.
V-E-G-E-T-A-B-L-E. Vegetable.
That is correct.
That is very correct.
All right. Ronnie, it's your turn.
Okay.
And your word is a fourth grade level word.
Okay.
Your word is penguin.
Yeah, that's a fourth grade book.
Yeah, it is. Fourth grade level word. You laughed, Aaron, right? Because that's an easy one, right?
Yeah, it's pretty easy.
P-E-N-G-U-I-N.
Ronnie, That's correct. That's right. I'm going to ask Aaron now. This is a real battle. The word is several.
S-E-V-E-R-A-L.
That is correct. That's right. All right, we're still on fourth grade level. Okay. Ronnie, the word is predator.
P-R-E-D. A-I-T-O-R.
I'm sorry, Ronnie, that's wrong. Okay. All right, Aaron shaking his head. Predator. Predator.
P-R-E-D-A-T-O-R.
That is correct. You are now,
now
you
you're
are
ahead.
Now ahead 3-1.
Yes.
Predator.
3-1.
Yes, he got the second one right, and then you got your second one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Don't worry. All right. Don't try to keep score too, Ronnie. Trust me.
Noine.
Ba ba boo wee.
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 Ba ba boo wee.